Allen Lund Company, 47 years young and a proud sponsor, wishes OOIDA all the best as you celebrate 50 years.
OOIDA, representing America's truckers since 1973, presents Landline Now with your host, Mark Reddick.
The ongoing United Auto Workers strike against GM, Ford, and Stellantis is making headlines, but how is it affecting you? Jason Miller of Michigan State University's Eli Broad College of Business joins the show to answer that question. He'll also tell us why he's less optimistic about spot market conditions improving anytime soon. What's involved in tracking your fuel taxes, and how do you avoid getting into problems reporting it? Tom Crowley and Kristopher Snyder of OOIDA's Business Services Department join the program to discuss that, plus provide information on updating your authority and predatory towing. And finally, the market registered a slight decrease in load volume last week, but a seasonal bump in freight is right around the corner. Ashley Blackford has more details coming up in today's market update with DAT. But first, the news with Scott Thompson.
Thanks, Mark. Our top story today. A bill in the U.S. Senate that would stop FMCSA from imposing a speed limiter mandate has picked up another supporter. Senator Joni Ernst of Iowa is Senate Bill 2671's ninth co-sponsor. So far, all 10 names on the DRIVE Act, as it's otherwise known, are from the Republican side of the aisle. We asked the bill's sponsor, Senator Steve Daines of Montana, what it's going to take to get bipartisan support.
Well, I think it's really important that the folks at the grassroots level and our associations are working together to call their senators, call their members of Congress to push back on this radical agenda. And I think it's another reminder about elections having consequences.
It's the same for the House version of the bill, which has 30 co-sponsors, all of them Republicans. The Owner-Operator Independent Drivers Association supports the DRIVE Act and is asking its more than 150,000 members to encourage their lawmakers to become co-sponsors. OOIDA contends that speed limiters create dangerous speed differentials and that speed limits should be left up to the states. The United Auto Workers Union just expanded its strike against the big three automakers again. About 5,000 workers walking off the job at GM's factory in Arlington, Texas on Tuesday. The plant, which makes big high-margin SUVs like the Chevrolet Tahoe and Cadillac Escalade, is a big moneymaker for GM. The strike here is by design. UAW leadership is trying to bring financial pain to GM, Ford, and Stellantis by targeting their most profitable factories. Regardless, the two sides are still far apart in negotiations. The UAW is asking for big wage increases and better benefits for its members. About a third of the union's 146,000 members at the three companies are now on strike. In response, the automakers are laying off workers at other plants amid an increase in parts shortages. California is putting Cruise robo-taxis in a timeout. The California DMV on Tuesday suspending Cruise's license to test and operate its fully driverless vehicles throughout the state. The suspension applies only to the fully self-driving vehicles, ones that don't have a safety driver on board. The California DMV said it was making the decision over safety concerns, adding that Cruise had, quote, misrepresented information related to safety of the autonomous technology of its vehicles. No other details were released. The move comes after numerous incidents on San Francisco roadways involving Cruise robo-taxis, including a deadly crash a few weeks back. Waymo's license remains intact in California, and as such, the company may continue operating driverless taxis in San Francisco. Cruise also has driverless fleets in Arizona and Texas and plans to continue operating them there. Traffic congestion on U.S. highways added nearly $95 billion in added cost to the trucking industry in 2021. That's according to a new study published by the American Transportation Research Institute. The $95 billion mark is the highest level recorded through ATRI's annual survey. It also found that congestion led to a total of 1.2 billion hours of lost productivity in 2021. ATRI's analysis also found that the trucking industry wasted over 6.7 billion gallons of diesel fuel in 2021 due to congestion, resulting in more than $22.3 billion in additional fuel costs. You can take a look at the numbers yourself on ATRI's website. The rewards program for Quick Trip was a target of a cyber attack earlier this month. In a statement to Quick Rewards program members Monday, the company provided few details about what happened, referring to it only as a cybersecurity incident. Customers hadn't been able to redeem or accumulate rewards for about 2 weeks, but Quick Trip says those issues have now been resolved. Any cards that were swiped during the outage should have received credits for those purchases, and rewards associated with those purchases should now be updated and available to use. Through November 5th, members will also get double visits for every purchase, both in-store and at the pump. Meanwhile, Estes Express continues to regain its footing following a cyber attack earlier this month. The less-than-truckload carrier's president and chief operating officer, Webb Estes, said in a recent social media post that their information technology systems are slowly returning to action. Also working now, the Estes Express website, MyEstes, and shipping applications.
So once again, you can get rate quotes, request pickups, and track your shipments all online.
But Webb Estes also acknowledged that not all of the company's systems are back up and running normally.
And we've also restored our image document retrieval API. Please know that we're working hard to get all scanned images into our system so that invoicing can resume soon.
Estes previously confirmed that its IT systems were the target of the cyber attack. A Colorado trucking company involved in a deadly crash a year ago wasn't insured at the time. That's according to a new court filing recently reported on by 9 News. The incident happened in June of last year in Weld County, Colorado, along Interstate 25. A truck driven by Jesus Puebla crashed into a stopped car, killing 5 family members. Puebla was driving for Caminantes Trucking, which, according to a lawsuit, did not have insurance for more than 2 years leading up to the crash. The court filing alleges that State Farm Insurance canceled Caminantes' insurance policy in 2020 due to, quote, severe safety violations and unsafe history. And while State Farm was obligated to inform the Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration about the company's lack of coverage, it never did. FMCSA, as a result, allowed Caminantes to continue operating for years without insurance, even working with the U.S. Postal Service over that time. The lawsuit filed by family members of those killed in the crash names Caminantes, State Farm, and USPS. There's also a criminal lawsuit in Weld County against the truck driver, who has been charged with vehicular homicide. New details tonight into a string of cargo theft cases in the Philadelphia area. You may remember earlier this year in the spring, we told you about more than 2 million dimes that were stolen from a tractor trailer that had just picked up the coins from the U.S. Mint in Philadelphia. An unsealed indictment claims that after the theft, thousands of dimes were converted into cash at coin machines in Maryland and through deposits to at least 4 different suburban Philadelphia banks. Prosecutors believe that the $234,000 in stolen dimes was just one of many robberies pulled off by the suspects, who are accused of also stealing things like frozen crab legs, meat, beer, and liquor from other trucks. 4 Philadelphia men have been arrested and charged with various crimes. And finally, the American Transportation Research Institute has a new survey out. The institute is trying to find out what are the best ways to recruit women as truck drivers and what's the best way to keep them in the profession. It starts with trucking fleets. ATRI is asking them to weigh in through an online survey that will document current recruitment communication channels, effective recruitment messaging, and initiatives aimed at creating a positive company culture. It will also be recruiting people to take part in virtual interviews. The deadline for this survey is November 17th. A second survey to solicit truck driver input on the same topics will launch later this year. The survey is part of a larger study identified by ATRI's Research Advisory Committee as a top research priority. The overall study will identify challenges unique to women truck drivers and point out some best practices for overcoming them. That's Lane Line Now News for today. I'm Scott Thompson.
Thanks, Scott. Next, we'll cover the UAW strike's effect on trucking and more with Jason Miller of Michigan State University. We'll hear about IFTA taxes from Tom Crowley and Kristopher Snyder of OOIDA's Business Services Department. And Ashley Blackford discusses an upcoming seasonal bump in freight with Robert Rouse of DAT. We'll be back in just a moment with more news and information. I'm Mark Redig, and this is Landline Now.
Thanks for listening. Be sure to like and subscribe. If you want more content, go to landline.media to get updated news, information, and archived editions of our show. Once again, that's landline.media.
Control your toll costs and eliminate tolling headaches with PrePass Tolls. PrePass Tolls means toll volume discounts. Just one invoice for all tolls and fewer violations. Call 877-878-5970 or go to prepass.com.
Attention all truckers, Dean Michael, the tax doctor here. I want to talk to you about those dreaded tax problems. I know you want to keep on trucking and not even think about them, but let's face it, they're not going away all on their own. You need professional help. I've been helping truckers put their tax problems in the rearview mirror for years. I can help you too. Call me now for a free consultation at 888-557-4020 or go to mytaxhelpmd.com. It's like I always say, keep your eyes on the road, I'll keep mine on the IRS. 888-557-4020.
It's tested and proven. Burn 2.1% less fuel when you balance all-wheel ends with Centromatic. Call 800-523-8473 to get the OOIDA discount.
Landline Now, welcome back. As you already know, the conditions within the trucking industry are dependent on a lot of factors out of our control, such as the UAW strikes currently going on. But understanding what strings are being pulled can oftentimes help us understand where things are headed. Joining us with some insight into the current conditions out there is Jason Miller. Jason is the interim chair of the Department of Supply Chain Management at Michigan State University's Eli Broad College of Business. Professor Miller, thanks for joining us again. We appreciate it.
Hey, thanks for having me on.
I want to start with all this UAW stuff that's going on out there, the strikes against GM, Ford, and Stellantis specifically. We're nearly, 6 weeks in now, I think, and more walkouts seem to be taking place day by day and week by week. On the surface, it might not seem like the strike would have much of an impact, maybe, on everyday trucking operations. So I want to start there by asking that. Basically, what effect, if any, are these strikes having on the supply chain right now?
So the original three-plant strikes didn't actually have much of an impact. For example, if you go back to September of 2019, when we saw all of GM go on strike, we saw about a 5% seasonally adjusted decline in light truck assembly, so, you know, trucks, SUVs, et cetera, compared to where we were in August. September of 2023, light truck assemblies actually went up on a seasonally adjusted basis from August by about 3%. Now, that's nationally. Those original three plants going down didn't have much of an impact. However, we've now seen three more plants, and these are some of the mega plants for Stellantis, Ford, and GM, producing some of their most profitable vehicles. These plants are very, very, very large. And so the loss of those three facilities producing is going to have a more meaningful impact on trucking volume. So I would anticipate October assemblies will be, you know, down on a seasonally adjusted basis from September.
Yeah, and the UAW obviously chose those plants specifically knowing that they were profit makers and would hit, you know, hit the companies where it hurt the most in the pocketbook. In terms of the effect of this, who is feeling the pinch of these strikes the most right now in terms of the supply chain?
Yeah, so I mean, right now the biggest impact is being felt by the parts suppliers. We're starting to see increased layoffs at a lot of those suppliers. There are some concerns of companies potentially even permanently going out of business if they do not have the, you know, financial reserves to survive an extended period of declining volumes, especially for, let's say, small manufacturers that really only worked with the big three. They're in a much more precarious situation. We've also seen other plants where we haven't had strikes yet for the big three have had to, you know, let go of folks because they can't produce parts for an assembly plant that shut down.
Yeah, in some of these cases, it's hard, at least for me, to make heads or tails of how this is going to affect, you know, truck drivers in particular, owner-operators in particular. When you're looking at these strikes, I've been asking myself and kind of looking around, and I haven't necessarily gotten a good answer, I don't think. But is this something that owner-operators are eventually going to feel the effects of, especially if this goes on for, you know, several more weeks or maybe even months?
So it really depends, you know, for these facilities, what the routing guide structure looks like. If it's routing guides that are going heavily towards brokers and those brokers' carrier stable is owner-operator-centric or, let's say, for-hire owner-operator-centric, then you'll see that impact. But if the routing guide is more to asset-based carriers, then you're not going to have the impact. And without knowing what those routing guides look like, it's difficult to say one way or another.
Yeah, yeah, I guess that does make sense. And just to kind of wrap this up in a bow here, I mean, the overall effects of these strikes, looking at consumers, looking at the greater economy, are we going to see any ripple effects there, especially as we enter the holiday season? I know we're talking about vehicles, but, you know, just as an overall picture, what are we looking at here?
The broad sector of transportation equipment manufacturing, which is what includes all motor vehicles and parts, believe it or not, accounts for only about 3 to 4% of all ton miles hauled by for-hire trucking companies. So this is taking out maybe 1.5% of ton miles at the absolute utmost at the moment. So from an overall volume standpoint, it's not that big of an impact, but it's taking volume out of a freight market that's been in a recession really since the end of the second quarter of 2022. And so it certainly prolongs this pain that we're going to be that we have been going through from a pricing standpoint, because without those volumes, there's no way we're going to see any type of inflection in the spot market.
Yeah, which kind of helps us transition into our next topic here. You know, we've officially entered peak trucking season, easy for me to say. Holidays fast approaching, obviously. I saw something the other day, numbers from the Cass Freight Index that indicate we're off to a slow start. Perhaps not a surprise to anybody out there. But is that what you're seeing too right now as you look at the numbers?
Yeah, no, I co-publish my own index with the Emboli Moy at the University of Tennessee that measures trucking ton miles. And this is a very weak summer. You know, we're down. We're effectively right now running about the same amount of freight we were running this time in 2018, but we're doing it with about 4% more capacity, which is why the rate environment is so low at the moment. You know, the retailers have brought in a good amount of imports. I mean, we've seen that, you know, compared to 2019, containerized imports for September were up about 8%, from where they were. So it's not like we've seen a collapse of, you know, freight volumes, but it's just soft out there more than anything because we just still have so much capacity. And certainly from a pricing standpoint, we're nowhere near an inflection where we would expect that dry van spot market to turn, which is always the leading indicator that eventually contract rates are going to get pulled up.
Yeah, I guess that's a good question is, you know, what is going to be that thing that does spur us back onto the right track here as we've been kind of looking for signs of life and light at the end of the tunnel of all this? Is it really just, capacity at the end of the day? When we start to see that turn, is that going to be the thing that kind of spurs us on to a better place?
So I do not believe that. So we have never exited a bear market pricing cycle because too much capacity left the market. That has never happened to the best of my knowledge. We always enter a bull market pricing phase because we have some type of surge of demand, at least on some lanes. Whether that's the fracking and commodity market boom of 2013, 2014, whether it's the COVID-19 consumer spending boom that caused volumes on some lanes to explode come about June of 2020, it's always a demand side phenomenon. Right now, there's nothing that I can see that's really going to stimulate demand that much until we start to see the Federal Open Market Committee start to lower the federal funds target rate. And that's going to take inflation being, perceived to be under control. And it's also likely going to take the Fed perceiving that the labor market has cooled to the point that a wage price spiral is not going to happen. Given how strong job growth is, given how low unemployment claims are, and given that inflation is still well above that 2% target by the Fed's preferred measure, I don't see interest rates going down until maybe third quarter of 2024,
wow,
which then puts us beyond peak home building season. And so my general view is that I'm pretty not excited about 2024 from a volume standpoint and think it may legitimately take till 2025. If we can start to see interest rates coming down, that will spur home building activity and that will spur, I'd say the big thing is home building, as we're kind of in a, we've collapsed 20% from where we were in terms of housing starts in 2021. Now, we are actually running a few percent above where we were in 2018 and 2019 for single family starts, but I don't see a very good scenario where those starts start to increase substantially in 2024. I think we're looking at 2025.
That is not great to hear because we've been talking to people and hearing from different, you know, economists over the past several months. They thought maybe in the second quarter of 2024, we'd start to see this environment turn a little bit. We'd start to see things pick up again. You're looking at things now, this being October, and seeing that it might be even longer. It might be into 2025 before we see really things start to pick up again. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yeah, no, it is. And so the way I was always looking at it, especially over, you know, a few months ago, was an absolute best case scenario would have said Q2 2024 is when the first possibility of a meaningful uptick happens. But I've become a little bit more pessimistic as time has went on, because the signals from the Federal Reserve that they're not going to be lowering interest rates anytime soon. If we had very strong signals right now of the Fed saying, hey, we were expecting, you know, probably to start cutting interest rates in February, let's say, then I would say, okay, we could see a surprise volume surge come the spring if we see a, you know, major increase in home building activity. But I just don't see that happening right now. And the other thing to keep in mind is China is suffering from a lot of economic issues that pushes down U.S. exports. And a lot of manufacturing activity in Europe is very depressed, especially Germany. And there's a lot of U.S. manufacturing, and manufacturing is still the source of the majority of trucking volumes. You know, we're very dependent on global trade, and some of our biggest trade partners are not doing that well, and doing substantially worse than us. And so it's very difficult to see, you know, any type of surge of demand coming, let's say, from Europe anytime soon that spurs more U.S. exports.
Yeah. I mean, all I can do is sigh when I hear these things. And it's good to know, because it's helpful information that, again, helps people plan out there for what's going on and what may be coming down the road here. You know, and with that in mind, I want to ask you, because all of this, it feels bleak for people out there dealing with this on an everyday basis and going through the grind and looking at these rates out there that are so low that it really is hard to keep their head above water. You've got your finger on the pulse of this industry and everything that's going on out there. I'm wondering if maybe you have any advice or maybe some words of encouragement for people out there who, again, are just tired of the grind, just looking forward to getting beyond all of this madness of the current cycle. What would you say to them?
So, I mean, the biggest thing that we've seen, because, you know, we've even seen the CEO of Knight Swift saying, we're surprised capacity is not exiting more rapidly than it is. And all I can point to is the fact that contract rates have been far more resilient than spot rates. And we see this time and again, whether it's gas broker buy rates or whether it's the Bureau of Labor Statistics producer price indices for different subsets of trucking, which is very heavily contract rate influenced. And so I think the biggest takeaway from this is we had so many firms that really put a lot of their eggs in the spot market basket in the back half of 2020, all of 21, and the first half, let's say, of 22, and they maybe don't have that network of, you know, shippers with whom they have those contract rates with that are far less fungible as market conditions change. And so I think that the one thing right now is, you know, if you are very spot market exposed, is trying to identify, are there some local shippers, you know, that you could work with to get those, you know, to establish, you know, some type of contract rate for head haul lane, and then use the load boards, use the brokers for those back hauls. We are seeing, you know, those contract rates have held up substantially better than spot rates. And so I think that that is the biggest thing right now. And, you know, the other thing that makes me think that it's going to be a fairly blah 2024 from a pricing standpoint is it's hard to see where a volume surge comes from. But we're also not seeing any evidence yet of a massive amount of capacity exiting. There's just too many data points suggesting that that isn't indeed the case. You know, if demand is not going to increase, but supply is not leaving that quickly, then it's difficult to see how pricing improves substantially.
Yeah, solid advice, solid information as always, Professor Miller. Sadly, we're out of time. We could talk to you all day, but we'll have to leave it there. We appreciate your time and your information today.
Hey, thanks for having me on.
Our thanks to Jason Miller of Michigan State University's Eli Broad College of Business. Stick around. Landline Now is back right after this.
Firestone tires are for more of everything.
more miles for every tire dollar, and more confidence in your fleet. At Firestone, we help fleets save with dependable value. Find your local Firestone dealer today at firestonetire.com/dealer.
Ready to make more money? Use a better load board. For a limited time, get 50% off Truckstop Load Board Pro. Just go to truckstop.com/go and enter promo code READY2023 when you purchase Load Board Pro.
When it's time to overhaul your truck engine, help protect it by insisting on a genuine Vibratech TVD crankshaft damper. Heavy duty, absolute premium quality, and they're made right here in the USA. Find a dealer at VibratechTVD.com.
Landline Now, welcome back. What's involved in tracking your fuel taxes and how do you avoid getting into problems in reporting it? Here is some information on that and more are Tom Crowley and Kristopher Snyder of OOIDA's Business Services Department. Guys, thanks for joining me.
Thanks for having us. Good to be here, Mark.
So let's go to the basics here. How did we do this back in the old days, Tom?
Well, back when I started trucking, it was with a pen, a notepad, and your receipts. And every time you crossed the state line, you picked up that notepad, you wrote down your odometer miles, and every time you got fuel, you know, you obviously kept track of those receipts so that you could do your IFTA. You done it on paper, and you would mail it in along with the check. Now it's more Chris's world now. Everything's a little bit more digital.
Let's talk about what is it like in Chris's world?
As far as what, Mark?
As far as tracking your IFTA mileage.
Well, these days your ELD can track your IFTA miles. You just have to make sure you have a compliant model. But the main thing to focus on is a IFTA compliant ELD will ping your location every 15 minutes, whereas just standard ELD for hours of service tracking is every 60 minutes. So it's important that you make sure you got the right one.
Okay. Where do people run into trouble on this?
Especially when ELDs first came out, you know, everybody thought, well, the ELD, that'll do my IFTA, that'll do everything. Well, the ELDs, when they first came out, they came out and to comply with the hours of service, with the FMCSA requirements. They would say, because, you know, they did track your movements, oh, yeah, we're good for your IFTA too. Well, not really were they good for the IFTA too, because like Chris was mentioning on the pings, the ELDs, they'll ping once an hour. And if you're on personal conveyance, even less, you know, because they just don't keep that close a track of you. Where IFTA requires all miles to be accounted for. It does require a ping every 15 minutes and a location. Also with IFTA, you know, not just the ELD tracking, but you got to keep track of your gallons that you purchase in each state. So, you know, that's something that if you've got a good ELD that tracks IFTA and that has an option to enter the fuel that you purchase in each state, well, you probably have what would be considered a compliant ELD for IFTA purposes. But if it doesn't do those things and IFTA comes back and wants to do an audit on you, then you got problems, because the first thing IFTA does when they do an audit is disallow everything and you must reprove it all. And if you don't have the documentation or the correct computer documentation still to prove it all, then bad things happen. IFTA does this crazy thing with dropping you to 4 miles per gallon and you get to pay the difference. And that can be a big difference if you run a lot of miles.
And not all of these e-log companies are going to store your logs past the retention date. So it's important that you go on there and you pull that, do a download or whatever you have to do to have those documents, because that company doesn't care whether or not you're passing your IFTA audits. You know, you've got to be responsible for keeping that documentation up to date.
That's a good point, because for the ELDs, for FMCSA requirements, you have to be able – the ELD – retains that information for a period of 6 months. After 6 months, they are no longer retained that information. So if you haven't went and downloaded it and got a copy of your stuff, after that 6 month period, you may not be able to. Well, IFTA will go back 4 years for an audit. They can go back up to 4 years. So if you're relying on that ELD for your IFTA information and you haven't been downloading it and you get an IFTA audit a couple of years down the road, you're but could be in a clink, you know. I mean, it could go bad for you.
Just to tag along on that, not necessarily IFTA, IRP requires 6.5 years of retention. So you should be keeping these downloads for a very long time, yeah, just to be safe.
You know, I think if I go back in my tax information, Mark, I bet I got logbooks back from the late 80s and 90s. So, you know, keep that stuff.
A little bit of digital hoarding may be called for in this case.
Yeah, well, you know, it is what it is.
Let's move on to another topic here, and that is updating your authority. And we've got some folks that had some questions about that. What's involved in updating your authority?
Well, in updating your authority is the biannual update. The FMCSA requires that you do that every 2 years or biannually. You go off of your DOT number or the last two digits of your DOT number, the second to last. So I get this right. Go ahead, Chris.
Second to last is odd or even year. If it's an odd number, it's an odd year. If it's an even number, it's an even year. And the last digit is the month that it's due, 1 through 9 being January through September, and then 0 being October.
Yeah. And so, and that's important that you update it during the month that your update is required. Now, the MCS 150 can be updated more often. If you've got your PIN number, you know, you can go on the FMCSA's website and you can update that more often. Say you get more trucks or change the amount of drivers you have. You can update that more often, but you must update it during your update month for it to count as far as what the feds say on your biannual. So that's really important to know those dates, what date and what if it's the odd or even year that needs to be updated.
These days, especially with the MCS 150, that's something you may want to be checking more frequently, right?
Yeah. With some of the scams that are going out there, and I think just about every show, Mark, we bring this up with the scams. There's just so many out there that as an owner-operator, as a driver, period, you've got to be diligent on checking this stuff. So I suggest to all small carriers or all carriers in general that you check your MCS 150 information, check your phone number. Check your email, check your address, and look at that stuff real carefully, because these scammers, if they can get into the system, they will change your email by one dot or by one letter, something that is kind of unnoticeable by most. And, you know, you see your email so often, you just scam over, oh, yeah, that's it. So, you know, check that stuff out. Make sure it's correct, because if a scammer is able to get a hold of your information and get in there and change your MCS 150 by some way. And you know, this stuff it's in the federal database, you know, and we hear all the time how this has got hacked or that has got hacked. So check that stuff out. Because if they can get in there and change that and they change your phone number and they change your email, all of a sudden they're out booking loads under your name. And weeks or months down the road, you're getting calls saying, hey, where's these loads at? And you're like, man, I got no idea what you're talking about. And come to find out some scammer got a hold of your information, hijacked it, and is using it. So it's really important, small carriers, go to the FMCSA's website, check out your information on your MCS 150, make sure it's correct. Definitely make sure it's correct.
It seems to me that we are running into more scams right now than I think I've ever heard of in all the time I've been involved in trucking.
Yeah, I would have to agree, myself too. I don't know if it's because of the digital age that it has made it so easy, or if it's I'm not sure if it's the lack of security that's involved, but it just the scams are running rampant. I mean, they come from all directions. You know, people get text messages from people claiming to be the DOT. The DOT does not text message. They're not that tech savvy. You know, they're not sending out they will send you an email, they will call you on the phone, but they're not sending you a text message. So anything you get a text message over, know that it's not the FMCSA or the DOT. It's a third party out there trying to get into your pocket.
Okay. Let's talk about another topic here, and this is another one where people are getting kind of hurt. In this case, predatory towing. What are we hearing on this topic? I mean, what type of towing is involved in this?
Well, I mean, there's a lot of different predatory things around that. You got a driver who they're asleep in their truck and they feel a rustle or whatever, and they got their truck lifted by a tow truck, and they're being told that they can pay the driver or be towed, and it's essentially extortion. Not only that, but the same thing with booting of the trucks. They'll boot it. You get out of your truck, and they're like, now give me some money, and I'll remove the boot for you. There's all sorts that is shady in that area.
There is. And you know, when it comes to towing, I mean, and some of that stuff, and like Chris mentions, is shady, but some of it is legal. I mean, some of these small communities, these smaller towns, you know, you used to, I couldn't tell you how many times I pulled into a Walmart parking lot and slept there for the night. Now, you got to be leery of that. You know, you might wake up in the middle of the night. Even if you pulled into a Walmart parking lot, got out of your truck and went into Walmart to shop, you can come back. And I've had people come back and say they had a boot put on their truck and it cost them $500-$600 to get it pulled off their wheel. These companies that do this, from what we've checked out, the ones that we've looked at, you know, the city or the township or the community, wherever, you know, it's legal for them to do this. And so, you know, you got to really be careful. You know, as far as predatory towing, there's the consensual tow and the non-consensual tow. You know, if you're a breakdown on the highway, a consensual tow is you called the tow company, you worked out a deal with them, they towed your truck to wherever and, you know, got it fixed. A non-consensual tow is usually, not always, but usually one that involves some type of an accident where the cops call whoever's the next on the rotation list. That tow company shows up with, you know, maybe you're just off in a median and got a tire stuck in a median and you just need a little tug out of there. Well, they show up with a couple of rotators and a crew of people and that never done anything other than sit on the job. And now when you get a bill, you get a $20,000 bill. There are all kinds of basically tow scams that go on. You know, as a small carrier, they're coming at you from all directions.
What is the way that you can avoid some of this? And let's talk about the booting. I mean, is this just a matter of making sure that you're not parking in retail parking lots, or is there a way around this?
Well, I don't know about a way around it. Yeah, if you're parking someplace, make sure you look around for signage, because supposedly before they can boot you, there has to be legitimate signage that says no truck parking. But, you know, as a truck driver myself for a lot of years, I parked a lot of places where it said no truck parking because there was no place else to park. And, you know, I had business to do or whatever needed to be done. So, man, it's a trucker beware type of situation. Some of these places with this booting, I mean, we've seen deals where they'll boot a truck and they'll tow the truck, claimed they towed the truck, when actuality they jimmied the door, jimmied the ignition, and drove the truck 2 miles, and now they're charging you, you know, $7,000-$10,000 for the storage and the tow of the truck. So I don't know of a way to tell you for sure to stay out of this other than to say, you know, don't park any place that you don't have an
explicit written consent.
Yeah, and exactly.
Consent. You can do it all right, and they'll still there's plenty of people out there who are willing to do it, whether you're doing it right or not.
Yeah, yep. There are plenty of people out there willing to try to get in your pocket and get your money regardless.
Let's go in the minute we have left here and just talk a little bit about random text messages from companies about reasonable suspicion testing. What are people hearing about that?
The most common one right now is reasonable suspicion, and it's essentially for carriers who have hired drivers or leased operators, not single owner operators. If you're a single owner operator, you are not required to do the reasonable suspicion training. If you have hired employees, you are. They are going to make you feel like you have to do it regardless. If it is something you're worried about, give us a call. We have that service here. We can offer that training. They're probably going to charge you an arm and a leg, and I'm not sure what ours is, but I know we're reasonable.
That's with any of these scams that are going on out there. If you get contacted and you're curious, you're concerned, you're worried, because some of these places, they use a scare tactic and they worry small new carriers. If you're worried about it, give us a call in the compliance department. Tell us what it is that's going on, and we'll tell you if it's something you need or not. 9 times out of 10, you don't need it, and if you do, you can probably do it yourself for free.
Okay. Guys, we're out of time here, but thank you very much.
Thanks for having us.
Absolutely.
And folks, if you do need to call about something like that, the number is 816-229-5791. Landline Now will be back in a moment.
Since you started, what you've loved about trucking is the freedom. Heading out on your favorite route, a good driving song, and thinking about truck insurance. Well, maybe not that last one. That's why we're here. At OOIDA, we have a full range of truck insurance products, expert advice, and great customer service, helping you get the right coverage for your operation. Go to OOIDA.com, because your job is to drive. Our job is to help with everything else.
Landline Now, welcome back. There are a number of critical questions you need to answer in order to run a successful trucking business. Among the most important of those questions are, where's the freight going to be, and how much is it going to pay? Today, Landline Now senior correspondent Ashley Blackford will bring us answers to both of those important questions with a look at this week's freight markets with the folks from DAT. Here's Ashley Now with the report.
Thanks, Mark, and hello once again to Robert Rouse with DAT. How are you doing today, Robert?
I'm doing great, Ashley. Thanks for asking.
Now, starting off, can you provide a detailed update on the events and developments that took place in the spot market during the past week?
Yeah, last week we saw just over a 1.3% decrease in total load volume, down to just over 1.1 million loads. As we said last week, this is where we expect to be for this time of year. We should see a traditional seasonal bump in freight in the second or third week of November as Christmas and early holiday goods get shipped out. So we should be right around this over the next couple of weeks. When we look at the number of trucks on the DAT load board, they increased by about 1.6%, up to 412,000 trucks. One of the interesting data points is that we saw all three equipment types increase between 1% to 2% last week. This is kind of what we would expect. As we were seeing less demand in the freight market, we'd continue to see some of these trucks coming back on the market. When we look at the overall strength of the spot market last week, we saw the load-to-truck ratios remain pretty flat for vans and reefers. When we look specifically at last week's reefer load-to-truck ratio, load-to-post remained relatively flat for the second week and was about 55% lower than last year, while carrier equipment posts were also flat and slightly below the average weekly load post volume for about 2023. And that resulted in last week's reefer loaded truck ratio remaining primarily flat at about 2.78. But in historical context, that's pretty close to what we saw back in 2019 as well. Lastly, when we talk about the national spot markets, the national benchmark broker to carrier spot rates without fuel stayed mostly flat, with only reefers seeing about a penny increase from last week. With three major holidays right around the corner, there's a variety of freight that is moving during the fall produce shipping season, so we should see some changes over the next couple of weeks. That said, until we see the large jump in load volumes, we expect pretty minimal rate movement until mid-November. Now, when we look at those rates a little deeper, you see fuel is really the fluctuation there. And while fuel, the part of the rate that is fuel, did decrease over the last couple of weeks, with the EIA coming out with their weekly number, we actually saw fuel jump 10 cents per gallon this week. So we should see those rates bump up at a higher level, but particularly just around that increase in the fuel prices for next week.
With Thanksgiving just over a month away, what should reefer carriers expect to be hauling?
Yeah, well, Thanksgiving is all about giving thanks and being with family. It usually includes what we can also like days of food and leftovers. One of the main Thanksgiving staples that is shipping as we speak is the centerpiece protein, the turkey. 88% of Americans surveyed by the National Turkey Federation eat turkey on Thanksgiving, and 46 million turkeys are eaten each Thanksgiving. And that's a whole lot of turkeys for just one holiday. With all of those turkeys getting shipped around the country, I wanted to share some interesting facts about the different temperatures that they're shipped at, because some people might not know some of these things. You might see some turkeys labeled as fresh and some as frozen. However, they're very similar in those. It's not really fresh. Turkeys won't freeze until they actually reach 26 degrees Fahrenheit. A fact I didn't know until last week. However, as the temperature of the turkey rises, its quality deteriorates and the potential for food safety issues increase. This is why many turkeys labeled as fresh are typically what they call hard chilled. It's an industry jargon, which means they're stored at temperatures ranging from 26 to 32 degrees. This ensures that they don't freeze, but yet they remain fresh and safe for consumption. Moreover, if you do purchase any hard-chilled turkeys, you can confidently freeze it since it hasn't been previously frozen. This method guarantees the best high-quality turkey that adequately thawed right before cooking. As with most frozen goods, most brokers and shippers are going to require the loads to be kept at a specific temperature. So be sure to take note whether your reefer needs to be pre-chilled and what temperature to maintain it at. And while looking where turkeys are being shipped all over the country, there's two states that stand out for turkey production. Minnesota produces more than 40 million turkeys a year. So you're going to see a lot of loads of turkeys coming out of Minnesota. The other state is North Carolina. They also produce more than 30 million turkeys a year. There's a few other states that have major producers of turkeys, include Indiana, Arkansas, Missouri, and Virginia, all also have some decent turkey numbers as well.
Now, the lack of adequate overnight truck parking continues to be an issue. Do you have any tips for drivers who may drive different routes on a routine basis?
Yeah, of course. About 87% of all truck parking is located at privately owned truck stops. And a 2016 study by American Transportation Research Institute found that the average truck driver spends about 56 minutes per day looking for parking, which translates to $4,600 in lost wages every single year. And over the past 7 years, that has likely gotten worse in many locations. A long-haul truck driver has to park each night to sleep, and the growth of trucking has outpaced how many parking spots are available to America's 2 million truck drivers. According to the OOIDA, there are 11 truck drivers for each parking space. At publicly owned rest areas and big travel centers, truck drivers usually struggle to find spots. Almost half of commercial truck stops operate at more than 100% capacity on weeknights. You know, with these findings, it's more than half of truck drivers actually park illegally at least 3 times per week. The shoulders of highways or on-ramps and off-ramps are the most common places for truck drivers to park when other sites are not available. The good news, hopefully, is the Truck Parking Safety Improvement Act was introduced in Congress and was unanimously passed by the House Committee on Transportation and Infrastructure. That legislation would allocate about $755 million over the next 3 years to create new truck parking spaces. However, even, you know, passed by Congress, the legislation is not going to completely solve the problem, which truck drivers surveyed by the ATRA said is their biggest problem. But there's some other less traditional suggestions to help solve some of these key issues. One that people are looking into is the use of parking lots of shopping malls. Most shopping malls were designed to accommodate large number of cars. In total, they have thousands of acres of parking spaces for employees and customers. However, once these malls close, the parking lots are empty and remain unused until next morning. So that's something that a lot of companies are looking into. When looking for parking today, you can use applications like DAT1 to find truck parking near you. A handful of states in the Midwest, like Kansas, Iowa, Indiana, have all installed a parking tracker at their rest areas, so that way you can see the live number of spots of how many spots are available, and you can see those right in the DAT1 app on the map. And depending on what route you are taking, when you have to deliver, another tip that drivers often use is to offset your drive time. So that way you're coming into a truck stop or in other parking early in the morning as it's emptying out. At every major truck stop in America, you usually see the parking lot start emptying out by between 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. And that's a great time to find parking. So if you find opportunities to deliver early in the morning and then take your break after that, that's always a great option as well, if that's a possibility.
All right. If our listeners want more information, where can they go for that?
Yeah, you can get the latest rate information at DAT.com/trendlines or look for the weekly market updates on the DAT blog. They're published every Wednesday. Or check out and subscribe to the DAT IQ channel on YouTube, where our analysts and forecasting teams take a deep dive into the freight markets each week.
All right, Robert, thank you so much.
Thanks, Ashley. Appreciate it.
That was Robert Rouse with DAT. Mark, back to you.
Thanks, Ashley. That's our program for today. Thank you very much for joining us. I'm Mark Reddick, and this is Landline Now.
Thanks for listening. Be sure to like and subscribe. If you want more content, go to landline.media to get updated news, information, and archived editions of our show. Once again, that's landline.media.
I'm a dad.
A son.
A husband.
Wife.
I'm a writer.
Photographer.
I farm.
I'm a veteran.
I love old cars.
Fishing.
My kids.
Chrome.
And
I am a professional truck driver.
And together, we are OOIDA.
OOIDA was founded by truckers to stand up and speak on behalf of truckers. We've done that by combining the individual voices of our members into a single, powerful voice. Protecting your interests, defending your rights.
Join us!
Make your voice heard. Join OOIDA, the Owner Operator Independent Drivers Association. Call 1-800-444-5791 or visit OOIDA.com.